This is the Rush Stories Podcast.
We've got 1, 2, 3, 6 million songs to play.
A series of podcasts with short stories, interviews, and background stories with people all around the globe related to the rock giants of Rush.
This episode is about the different bands Hugh Syme is working with, as well as the different bands such as Aerosmith, Megadeth and Iron Maiden. It's also about child projects, exhibits, growing up and future plans.
And they use lots of vintage letters and carved letters in wood or stone. And medallions and stamps
seals. Yeah, definitely. Well, that's, you're talking about White Snake. I actually had a brand made for Get a Grip. And naturally, I didn't go out and torture cows, but I did take. I did take some vellum paper, you know, handmade vellum paper, and I would heat the brand up and put on my oven mitts, and I would just burn the paper, and it was a beautiful look. And I then took that and then superimposed it in Photoshop, and then I spent 2 days drawing the hairs to go over top. So I didn't look pasted on, you know. But there's a means to an end on a lot of these projects. You know, I had the floor in Countdown to Extinction was CAD cut. If you're familiar with CAD, it's a digital process. So I gave the shape of the grill that I wanted to use for the drainage floor in Countdown to Extinction. That was cut out of plexiglass, and then I painted that and built the wall behind that. It was only It's a 4 foot wide wall, and I would sometimes recycle that drainage board. Looked so cool. I put it underneath a sculpture that I did of Eddie for Iron Maiden's X Factor. I use that same floor, but underneath Eddie to look like the drain on his torture table, because it looked good. You know, it was there. Some people have busted me for it and said, "Hey, that was on the counter." You know, I don't care. You know, it worked. It served the purpose. It started with art. I had to learn typography. I never studied it, but there was an interesting guy who worked in a place called. It was called the New Press, and he had a real old letter press, and he did a lot of invitation.
Okay. Gutenberg.
True letter press and so on. This guy had a beard down to here, wore overalls all the time, had the smallest little spectacles. His name was Stan, but he was the one who introduced me to Aldus as a beautiful kind of classical typeface, and I fell in love with it immediately, and I used it pretty uniquely on Rush on several projects. Stan had a Porsche parked out behind his shed, so he was doing very well. It was quite a non sequitur to see Stan, this kind of true 1971 kind of hippie, with his own Porsche, you know, parked out at the back. You know, I kind of got my education on the fly on that front. Started paying attention closely to journals, you know, design journals, and seeing what other people were doing. And I never studied kerning and leading and all that until I started to realize that, you know, and that's one of the sad things about desktop publishing is people don't know that you have to tuck the O under the W a little bit, because out of the box, it doesn't always look right. But the world has become forgiving. We don't know what, most people don't know what good typesetting is anymore because they haven't seen it for so long.
Yeah. You know,
good typesetting is a true art. Layouts are, I don't get as, I mean, some artists, some layout artists and designers really get into it. I tend to be a little more about the art. My layouts are not always kind of getting, I don't get heavily into textured type and layers. You know, a lot of people I've seen really beautiful, artistically rendered CD booklets and albums and so on, where the layout is as much the art, or sometimes even more so the art than the art. Yeah. My stuff is so conceptual and so visually designed to entertain in and of itself that I don't really want to put a lot of distracting, you know, Photoshop-y kind of layers just to keep it all feeling more organic, or I don't know. There's a certain level of indulgence, and I tend to cut my – I like clean communicative type that to me works. And I don't know if that makes me lazy or kind of responsible to the words, you know, because sometimes these words get so lost in the textures and the layering that you have to actually strain to actually read what they are. It's beautiful. Yeah. As beautiful as
those doom metal bands.
Yes. Yeah. Good example. Yeah. Yeah.
Ivania, did you?
Here
have...
I am.
Yeah. Welcome.
Thank you. So, talking about art, you, I know that you've been doing exhibition throughout the US.
Yeah.
And I wanted to know if there are any chances to see you in Italy and in Europe in general, and how do you feel about exhibiting your art? In a space, not just on the book, but
I love it. I've been to Austin two times to the AO5 gallery. Todd Gresley is the curator down there, and I did an art show in Indiana, which is not the demographic for my work. My work's too improbable. You know, people here, unless they happen to be coming as a Rush fan, you know. And several people were, and several people bought the artwork down in Atlanta. It's much more cosmopolitan, and it's just a hipper city. Sam Milgram, who owns a gallery in Los Angeles, and I have been talking for over a year. The pandemic put the brakes on so many plans, for, as we all know, for 2 years. But he has a place on Sunset Boulevard in L.A. called Mr. Music Head, and really, I mean, Paul McCartney's paintings are shown there. Ronnie Wood's paintings are shown there. Bob Dylan's paintings are shown there. Photographers like Mick Rock and Bob Gruen and Barry Wenzel, who used to be the staff photographer for Melody Maker in the 60s, who would photograph Bowie at age 17 and, you know, phenomenal rare shots. They get shown at these galleries, the Snap Gallery. Guy White owns the Snap Gallery in London. He wants to do a project with me. Brian Liss in Toronto, the Liss Gallery, also has the same kind of clientele. I have one person that corresponds with me and says that, I have two people actually. One wants me to go to Amsterdam or the Netherlands. Italy, my God, if I could do it, you know, a show in anywhere in Italy, apart from just the excuse to go there and hang out for a week. I'd love to do Italy. I'd like to do a show in, I had a gallery called, it's three numbers, but they are in Ulaanbaatar in Mongolia. They took an interest and reached out to me. I have a friend who's a factory owner who also has a dear friend in China who actually has an uncle who's an art collector, like super wealthy. So mm-hmm. We're talking. God knows what kind of art he collects, but, you know, doing a show in Beijing, what a trip, you know, I mean, it would just be a culturally interesting thing to, you know, and we're, you know, I jokingly say in interviews that we're all feeding off the carcass of what used to be the music business. There's a certain truth in that. If it wasn't for Dream Theater and Rush and the fact that I have a rep in New York, I just finished doing a project for Boston Beer, you know, and the pharmaceutical projects that I do with no degree of shame. It's just all part of surviving. But as far as having those three album covers a month that I've had for 30 years, it's not the same. It's not, it can't be, it's just not.
Yeah,
the same. Yeah. No. But I do get phone calls. I get emails from Fairy Tale called me from Czech Republic, and Barbora, whose last name I can't pronounce, but she sings as well or better than she's got a really trained voice, but got a powerful voice. And their band's called Fairy Tale, and she sings like the girl in Evanescence and then some, you know. Even, you know, old friends like Mark Zonder from Fate's Warning, you know, calling me out of nowhere saying I've got a project called A to Z, you know. So, you know, you get stabs from the past, you know, people doing new projects. What's his name? Caveman Shirley, you know, who's he's an Australian producer. And I've typeset his name on Iron Maiden, Dream Theater, and Rush. I've seen his name many times. I didn't know who he was, but it's my job to read through the liner notes. And ironically, 2 years ago, I discovered Joe Bonamassa, who's an astonishingly good guitar player and singer-songwriter. When Kevin reached out to me through Instagram and said he has a project, I thought he was talking about some rock project, you know, some rock project. When he said Joe Bonamassa, I thought, oh, this is what an honor, you know. So I got to work on his last album, which was a treat. Billy Sheehan, who worked with David Lee Roth, you know, I've always known about Billy. I've always admired his bass playing, and I knew he was in a band called Talus because the singer from that band grew up in Rochester, New York. The singer's name was Phil Narro, and Phil has a voice from the gods. He could sing like Plant. He could sing like Steve Perry. He could sing like Lou Gramm. Even though he grew up with Lou Gramm in Rochester, Lou got a gig with a little band called Foreigner. And Phil never really kind of got the break. And yet he had a voice that, you know, he used to work at do shows at Alex Lifeson's bar, which you should go to when you're in Toronto. Yeah.
I've been there.
Yeah. Well, I used to go see Phil, and he would do classic rock night, and suddenly you're hearing McCartney. Suddenly you're hearing David Coverdale. That's like almost dead ringers for all these voices. Unbelievable. He would do a whole Zep night, and it was all like Robert Plant, you know, better than Robert Plant sometimes, you know, just really. But Phil was, and so I got a call last year. Apparently there were tracks that they wrote back in 1984 before Billy went on to work with David Lee Roth. So because they kind of disbanded in 84, we called the album 1985, even though the songs were written then, they were re-recorded in Nashville. The vocals were done with my friend Russ Mackey at Blue Sound in Toronto. And then Russ called me and said, do you want to work on a cover for Talus? And I said, they're still around? He said, no, they're not really around, but they're doing a new album. And Phil, who passed away from throat cancer 2 years ago now, sadly, and ironically, because I say he's got the voice from God, what a cruel way for him to you know, become ill. But that project came out of nowhere, you know, and we had to think of something iconic from 1985. And then Russ and I were talking. He said, what about the ill-fated car, the DeLorean? So that became the cover. That's coming out, I think, on the 27th. So it's a pretty interesting album. It's definitely written in 1984. You can tell that. But it's got the sound. It's got some true classic rock sound, but with today's technology. So it's pretty cool. Yeah.
Well, guys, it came me now. I was looking at the clock, and it's been like 1.5 hours that we are talking to Hugh, and now we are coming to a close, you know. So okay. Last question, Hugh. Besides these projects that you mentioned, and most of all, this box.
You're coming to dinner this week, right?
Oh, maybe. Maybe. I will go around North America for a while. Well, but my final question is, now, first of all, thank you so much for accepting our invitation. It's been a great honor for us all. And of course, besides the projects you were talking about and the Signals box that I'm already saving money to buy it, what can you tell us about your work next year? What are your plans for 2023? Any work outside music? Maybe some projects with games or movies or something like that. Anything different?
Yeah, well, I'm developing there's a book in the works right now. The son of the songwriting team from the 50s, Felice and Budleigh O'Brien, if you're familiar with those songwriters, they wrote Wake Up Little Susie, All I Have to Do is Dream.
Yeah.
Bye Bye Love for the Everly Brothers, who were, I think, the Beatles' favorite
Love
band.
Love Hurts.
Love Hurts, yes. Yeah. This husband and wife team wrote some extraordinarily good music. Well, the son, Del, approached Spencer, who I referred to earlier in this conversation, about doing a book called All I Have to Do is Dream. So because my work kind of lives in that realm, that improbable, I hate to use the word dream because that relegates it to fantasy, and I don't think that's what I do. But because of its fit with All I Have to Do with Dream, I was approached, and they're kind of inviting me to create a showcase of my art, some of which I've done before, some of which I made specific for the book, I created for the book, but that book is in development. As a result of working on Mark Zonder's A to Z cover, I looked at it and I loved how ludicrous that zebra, it's actually a zebra with an apple in its mouth. And it's, I think it's a pretty cool cover. I'm happy with the cover. Its impact on me is much like when I first saw Toy Matinee with that kind of hideous, well, the vivacious, slightly hideous grin of that woman with the mustache ink onto her face. I liked the impact of A to Z, and I thought, wow, A to Z, I could do a book on alphabets, but it wouldn't be your typical little kiddie book where A is for apple, you know, B is for ball, C is for cat. You know, I challenged myself to create yet again a showcase. Some of the artwork pre-existed, some of it was created specifically for the book, but I actually wrote the text, which is kind of slightly poetic. There's little limericks that go with each letter. So that's in the works. It's being shopped right now for a possible publication. But I also did it because I just wanted to do it. My aunt was a concert pianist of note. She played Carnegie Hall. She played with von Karajan in Vienna years ago. She was a serious, she was the resident concert pianist with the Toronto Symphony at Massey Hall. For years, she was a true success, studied with Horjovsky in New York, and Horjovsky's mother studied with Leshtitsky. Leshtitsky studied with Chopin, you know, so her lineage was pretty cool, pretty cool. And I admired her so much, but she came off the road. She came off the touring of being a concert pianist and started her own radio program on CBC Canada. And it was weekly. She had to write new music every week, write a storyline, something engaging for children. And her music was not cutesy Saturday morning kind of music. It was really quite beautiful, sophisticated, but still, you know, she used to say, you never play down to children. Children are too smart. So she used to write and Debussy and Chopin, they wrote for children as well. So there's, you know, but she then did some writing for Sesame Street, but all of her stories and poems from her years of working on CBC Radio, I have. So the challenge in her lifetime was to get something out before she passed away, which I didn't manage to do, but I've made it sort of a promise to myself and a project, at least four or five, because I love Chris von Ahlberg's work with Polar Express and Jumanji and those stories. So doing a book for children, but not letting the artwork be kind of throwaway and primitive just because it's kids. You know, I would like to do a book full of rich illustrations. So yeah, I now know why my aunt wanted to live to 150. And Neil did too. Those things are on the horizon, but you know, I think gallery work would be really gratifying. If I can bring those shows together, that's a new frontier for me. I never did show during my career, so it's been fun doing that. So that's the stuff that's brewing. I don't know how much of it I can pull together, but yeah. I grew up 10 miles. I lived for 3 years after moving from Cornwall, which was my father's and mother's place when we were all born. And we grew up because my father was in pulp and paper. Then we moved to St. Catharines, which is literally 10 miles from Port Dalhousie. I grew up with this young guy called Larry, who was he had a really good underhand pitch, a bit of a brat, you know, a show off. but a really nice guy. And later on, he became Neil's drum technician for 15 years, Larry Allen. And, you know, I grew up with him. I grew up with Bobby King and his brother, John. You know, we were friends during our youth. And when I needed someone to, with a good physique, to stand and push away a red star, I thought, Bobby's built well, so let's bring him in. So we brought him in the studio. I said, take your clothes off. We're going to do a shot of you from behind. And because our budgets were not as robust as Pink Floyd at the time, we had to be kind of nimble and inventive. You know, that's why the Queen's Park Parliament buildings in Toronto became the gallery for moving pictures. And that's why the lead mover with the mustache in the foreground is Bobby. So he became the star man. He became the foreman for the moving crew. He also became the Magritte character on top of the brain in Hemispheres. So we came from the same part of the world as Neil, but I didn't know Neil till I was 19, you know, and asked to do a Caress of Steel. So
well, thank you very much, Hugh. It was
my pleasure. I appreciate you.
A very good time to spend with you guys, my colleagues, Asko, Stefania, Ronald. Yeah, thank you so much for this opportunity. Hugh, I wish you all the best. Unfortunately, I'll be in Toronto, but not your Indiana is your place now. Yeah.
When are you going to be there?
In 2 weeks. I arrive in Toronto in September 24th.
Yeah. Well, I haven't been back. Pandemic, partly pandemic. I just built a house here in Indiana. So that was, it took 7 months to get my windows, for example. So it's been, yeah, been a real challenge. But I built the house. I'm in it now and I love being here. But it took forever. So I haven't really kind of left this part of the world for, except to go to the Austin Art Gallery shows, you know, and stuff like that. But it's time I get back home because I've not been home to Toronto for probably 2.5 years now. Yeah. Well, I'm sorry.
Maybe you should go in 2 weeks so I buy you a beer.
just a beer?
No, that's come on, Hugh. I'm a Brazilian. You know, I'm the poorest person here.
I'll reconsider it if you buy me a Vesper Martini. Then maybe.
Okay. I agree to that.
Okay.
Bye. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you.
This was our podcast with Hugh Syme about his involvement with the art of Rush. Keep your eyes and ears open for more of our Rush stories in the near future. This podcast is made possible with a little help from our friends Kende Soldatelli, Stefania Sarre, Haskell Alanen, Ronald van Dalfsen, Bas Aldense, and a special thanks to Hugh Syme.